So you're sitting there, right? I assume you're sitting. I'm standing. But in any case, regardless of what you're doing, did you know tons of forces are acting on you right now? In your chair, what's pulling you down? Gravity. Okay, if that was the only force, what would happen? You would just fall down to the floor. So your good friend, Mr. Chair, is holding you up with a different force. Normally, multiple forces are acting on something at the same time. And to track those, we use something called a free body diagram, which lets us list all the forces acting on an object. Let's dive in. Let's review our lesson objectives. First, we'll introduce free body diagrams as a way to track forces on an object. Then we'll define some common forces that you need to be able to identify when drawing a free body diagram. And lastly, we'll practice drawing these free body diagrams so that you get really good at thinking through all the forces that are present. During a game of tug of war, multiple people pull on a rope from multiple directions. As is often the case in physics, we don't have just one force. We have multiple forces. Sometimes these forces add together. For example, the force applied by the team on the right, all of those people pulling, adds up to pull towards the right. But sometimes the forces cancel each other out. That's actually what the other team is trying to do. So it's a war of forces, not a tug of war. Let's call this a war of forces. All right, well, to think about these multiple forces on an object, we need a new tool, the free body diagram. What is a free body diagram, you ask? It's a way to show all external forces acting on an object. All right, well, that may not be super helpful for you. Maybe that still looks confusing. Let's just actually draw one, and then I think you'll have the idea. Here we have an anvil floating in air, right? And it's being held up by the rope. So what forces are present on this anvil? Well, provided it's around the surface of the Earth, which presumably it is, the most important force you probably think of is the force of gravity. Totally true. The force of gravity is pulling that anvil down. And whenever we're drawing forces in a free body diagram, we usually use a big F with a subscript to tell us what the force is. So here we have a big F and then subscript gravity. Okay, well, why isn't the anvil falling? Well, you know what? It's the rope. All right, that's exactly right. There's a force from the rope pulling it upward. Notice that these arrows are pointing in opposite directions. So this is just floating there in midair with two forces on it and without any motion because those forces are exactly the same size, it turns out. If gravity got too strong for the rope, it would fall. Okay, now this rope force, this force from the rope has a special name. We call it tension. It's a pulling force from a string or a rope or a chain. Basically, if something's hanging, you got yourself the tension force, okay? So when we write this in a free body diagram, we're gonna put F sub tension. So this subscript here says tension, and that's just talking about the force from the rope. Oh man, this is exciting. An anvil sitting still? You know what we'll look at next? A rock sitting still. Okay, but seriously, thinking about this is not so straightforward. What's the forces that are acting on this rock? Well, the first one you probably think of, once again, is gravity, and that's exactly right. Now, why isn't it just falling continually through the surface of the Earth? Well, because the ground pushes up on it. There's a force from the ground, and it's pushing upwards. It's holding the rock in its spot. This has a special name, and it's a little weird. We're going to take a deep dive into this force later, but for now, just take me at my word that this is something called the normal force. And what it is a pushing force from a surface. So whenever a surface is holding something up, you got the normal force. Remember how we talked about your chair holding you up? That's the normal force. So when we draw this in a free body diagram, we put F normal. And that's always the one that's gonna be opposing gravity when something's sitting still on the ground. Okay, so let's think about this free body diagram a little more carefully. One thing to know is that it can be drawn without a picture. You don't need a picture. So sometimes we draw on top of a picture, it makes it a little more clear. But when you're drawing these on your paper, you won't have a picture. It'll look like this. You'll have arrows pointing up or down that represent the different forces. And lots of times, what we use to represent the object is just a box. So a box will represent that object. Now, the size of the arrows really matter. The longer the arrow is, the stronger the force, okay? So we need to keep in mind that the size of those arrows really matter. Let's do another free body diagram. Here we have a car. It gets a little more interesting than the rock, right? So the force of gravity is here, as we might expect. What's going to be opposing the force of gravity? You guessed it. The normal force. That normal force is opposing the force of gravity. Okay, now what else is going on here? What other thing in this picture is generating a force? Well, you might realize, oh, you know what the car is? The car has an engine in it. And that's exactly right. We can call this the force of the engine. Now, when you start labeling forces like this, about something being pulled on or pushed on by an engine or by a person, the names aren't super standardized. So you can call this F engine. If you called it F of the car, that would also be fine. Now there's one more force here. Because that car is moving forward, right? We can see from the blurring in the picture that this car is moving, right? That means there's actually another force, and that's the force of friction. The friction force is something that always resists motions. And it can be caused by air, or it can be caused by surfaces. Okay, so friction is always there when we have motion. Now notice, I've drawn all of those arrows to be the same size. What does that mean? That means all the forces are equal. Whenever all the forces are equal, we have constant velocity. That means our velocity isn't changing. Here, the force of the engine, the fact that you're keeping your foot on the gas, is just to maintain a constant speed, which you may have noticed in a car. If you take your foot off the gas, you slow down. Why? The friction force. So you got to keep the force of the engine equal to the friction force to stay at the same speed. Let's zoom in for a second now on the friction force. Friction is always a resistance to motion. It's a resistance to motion. Now, let's dive in a little more detail. It's a resistance to motion caused by the matter in contact with the object. So what sort of objects could those be? Well, surfaces cause friction. So for example, the road. And air resistance causes friction. So air is matter. It takes up space, and to move through it actually requires opposing that force of friction. All right, now let's put this knowledge into practice. We're going to ask a few multiple choice questions that help you think about what forces are present. Which of the following circumstances involve friction? Well, A is an asteroid drifts through space. So remember, friction resists motion, and there's motion. But there's nothing else in contact with the asteroid because it's in space. So that's not friction. A chandelier hangs from the ceiling. Here, there's actually no motion, right? So there's no friction. A basketball drops from a height of 10 meters. Ah, now there's motion, something dropping, and it's in contact with the air. So we have air resistance. So that's going to have friction. Lastly, we have a cup of coffee rests on a desk. There, once again, no motion, so no friction. So C is the correct answer. A basketball that's dropping from a height of 10 meters will have the friction force. Okay, next question. Which of the following circumstances involve tension? Which of the following circumstances involve that force of tension? Pause the video and see if you can answer this one. If you said B, you're correct. And that's because the chandelier is hanging from the ceiling, presumably by a chain. And that chain exerts a tension force that holds the chandelier up. Okay, next question. Which of the following circumstances involve the normal force? Again, give this a try. If you said D, you were correct. Notice that the cup of coffee is resting on a desk, and that means that the desk is pushing up on the coffee cup, or it would be falling to the ground. So that's an example of the normal force. Okay, now that we've reviewed forces, let's go ahead and look at what it's like to draw a free body diagram. This is your chance to practice. So draw a free body diagram for all the forces on this wagon and assume that it's moving at a constant velocity. So pause the video and give that a try. Okay, let's go through the forces one at a time. First of all, we got gravity. We always got gravity. Gravity is pulling that wagon down. Next, we have the normal force, which is opposing gravity. That's why it's not falling through the surface of the Earth. So to be honest, lots of times in the free body diagrams, we can start with gravity and the normal force if it's resting on a surface. And those are going to be canceling each other out almost always, because what that means is it's just resting on that surface. Now we're also pulling on the wagon. So that's the force of that pull. Whenever we have motion, we're going to have friction force if our object is in contact with other things. Notice here it's in contact with the grass and with air, and so we have the friction force pointing backwards. All those arrows are the same size because it's moving at a constant velocity. Okay, if the size of the arrow thing doesn't quite click, don't worry, we're gonna take a closer look at that in the next lesson. Here's the free body diagram you might have drawn that wouldn't be on a picture. A square in the center to represent the wagon, the normal force up, gravity down, the pull forward, and the friction backwards. Let's take a look at what we've learned. We've introduced free body diagrams, a really useful way to start thinking about the forces acting on an object. We've defined common forces. Most importantly, we looked at the force of tension, which is whenever we have something hanging basically on a rope or a chain. We've looked at the normal force, which happens whenever something rests on a surface where there's gravity. And we looked at the force of friction, which always opposes motion, and it can be either air resistance or resistance from being in contact with a surface. Lastly, we practiced drawing free body diagrams. Hey, hey.